Before I get started, this is a video about The Legend of Zelda, which is one of those games where you have to go through all the standard reviewer cliches, so let me get those out of the way. Classic. Started it all. Set the standard. Paved the way. One of the most. Of its time. Of all time. Video game history. And now I say something like, The Legend of Zelda changed the face of gaming. This game set the standard for the action-adventure genre and paved the way for one of the most beloved franchises in video game history. And you'd think that would be a fitting description for a game that's the precursor for Breath of the Wild, which is the game that has received the highest number of perfect scores out of every game ever reviewed. But does The Legend of Zelda actually live up to its own reputation? I'm sure some of you have already hit the dislike button just for the sheer blasphemy of having asked the question.
How dare you, sir?
How dare you?
No, how dare you?
No, how dare you?
How dare you? No, how dare you?
Who am I to question the classics? Especially since before making this review, I had never actually played the original Legend of Zelda for more than about 3 minutes. In fact, my first experience with the series came in 1998 with Ocarina of all time. And since then, I've been able to play all the other Zelda games I possibly could, with the exception of the first two. So going just by their reputations, I could only assume that the first Zelda was at least as good as A Link to the Past, which is very good, and Zelda 2 was at most as good as the Wand of Gamelon. But I digress. I'm telling you this because I want it to be clear that my view of the original Zelda is not going to be tainted by any feelings of nostalgia. Good for its time does not necessarily mean good. And I've been burned before playing games that came highly recommended by people who hadn't played them since 1989. Don't freak out, I'm only half joking. I'm not joking when I say that when I finally played the first two Zelda games, I thought that maybe their reputations had gotten switched somehow, because I found Zelda 2 to be fairly straightforward, if a little bit difficult, and the first Zelda to be a classic example of poor video game design. I'll give credit where credit is due. The actual playing of the game, the basic mechanics, work just fine. Swinging the sword, blocking with the shield, using special items in different situations. It's simple enough to make you feel confident that you can fight anything, but the enemies are challenging enough to test your skill. Making your way from room to room in a dungeon, solving simple puzzles, and collecting new special items gives a nice feeling of accomplishment. And the game gives you an initial feeling of openness and possibility when you first start to explore. And I think these are the things that people are remembering when they're rhapsodizing about The Legend of Zelda, the stuff that worked. And I would agree if that's all the game was about. If it was just a series of dungeons, one after the other, I wouldn't have any complaints except for the incessant music. But the dungeons are only half the game. The problems with Legend of Zelda are in everything else. The aimless wandering, the unnecessarily vague clues, finding dungeons, figuring out what order to complete them in. Worst of all, discovering secrets that lead to upgrades that are all but necessary in order to complete the game's more difficult dungeons. Now you're gonna have to pretend like you don't already know all the game's secrets so that I can make my point, because it's easy enough to take all the solutions for granted and brush all the obscurities aside in retrospect. I'm trying to make the argument that 30 years of Zelda experience has tainted the generally accepted view of this game's design, and the easiest way to see the flaws would be to strip all of your prior knowledge away and just try to see the game as someone who has never played a Zelda game would see it. The problems with The Legend of Zelda start from the basic ideas behind the game. Back before Tech TV was shut down and replaced with an awful, awful thing, they did an interview with Shigeru Miyamoto who said, "Well, actually, we first started work on Zelda about the same time that we started work on Super Mario Bros. For the NES. The Mario game was essentially a very simple action where anyone could look at the screen and know exactly what it was that they needed to do. Whereas with Zelda, we really tried to create a game where we would put the player in a situation where they wouldn't know exactly what they needed to do next." And in this interview with SuperPlay, he said, "Since the same teams did both the games, we tried to separate the different ideas. Super Mario Bros. Should be linear, The Legend of Zelda should be the total opposite." And they took this opposites thing way further than it probably should have gone. Like he says, you can look at a single screen of Mario Bros. And know exactly what you're supposed to do. Run forward, avoid these guys, hit those blocks, collect the coins, don't jump in the pits, hit the flagpole, level 2, repeat. The objective is easy to figure out, and the game teaches you while you play. The challenge is in completing the actions to achieve the objective. You have to time your jumps properly, you have to manage your speed, you have to wrestle with physics. Zelda is the exact opposite, by design. It's easy enough to figure out the actions to perform, and it's easy enough to complete those actions. Walk around, swing your sword, kill the dudes, collect some rupees. Cool, I got some rupees. Now what? The challenge here is figuring out the objective. Remember, you've never played this game before.
And when I first showed an early prototype of the NES version of Zelda, it did not go over well in Japan. People were confused. They didn't know their objective. They didn't know how to move from stage to stage. They couldn't even solve the puzzles.
Normally, in an open-world game, characters will offer suggestions on what to do or where to go, and the player is free to follow instructions or explore other areas as they choose. Nowadays, this follows the main quest, side quest structure. Characters give you an ultimate goal and a suggestion for what to do or where to go to achieve it, but you're free to explore and find other things to do that might help you achieve the ultimate goal. Or in Breath of the Wild's case, bake some apples in a brush fire just because you can. The Legend of Zelda was one of the first open-world action-adventure games, so it obviously doesn't include modern conveniences like objective screens. Instead, quite the opposite, it dumps you onto the first screen with no direction and no characters to tell you what you're supposed to be doing. I'm not saying this is necessarily a bad thing, after all it worked for Super Mario Bros., but being the opposite, Zelda has no intuitive in-game clues to give you any direction either. Straight out of the gate, your task really is to wander aimlessly until you stumble into a dungeon which you may or may not be able to complete, because it could contain a fight you can't win unless you collect a certain item that's in a certain other dungeon that can't be reached before completing a different dungeon that you haven't found yet. There's nobody to tell you what you should do and when you should do it. You can contrast this with every Zelda game since, including the latest one, where paths on the ground lead you to people who can help. You can even look to one of this game's contemporaries, Final Fantasy, where every town you enter is full of NPCs giving you objectives and directions in which to travel. Now, you might say they couldn't put more characters or more explanatory dialogue into the game because of limited memory issues, but as the story goes, the original completed game only took up half the disk space, and they created the second quest to fill the other half. So I don't know how far you're gonna get with that excuse. And even if limited memory was a reason for limited dialogue and limited instruction, you would think that would mean they would try to make what little dialogue they have more meaningful than grumble grumble. And that's not a small problem, because you need to know what grumble grumble means to beat the game. Much of the time, your success relies on your ability to decipher hints, some of which have not been definitively solved to this day. Although, the Zelda Wiki has been able to determine that the Eastmost Peninsula is likely named after a peninsula. I guess that's one mystery solved. Secret power is said to be in the arrow. The only way this could be less specific is if it said, an object does a thing. Imagine how ridiculous this would be in a modern game. Imagine what an Elder Scrolls game might be like with a total of 7 NPCs, and the most helpful thing you can get out of any of them is, "What ho, citizen! There is treasure in a cave!" As it turns out, this is all intentional because Shigeru Miyamoto wanted to make a game that required cooperation to complete.
I thought that Zelda could create a different kind of communication centered around the game itself. I wanted them to talk with other Zelda players and exchange information. Ask each other questions. Find out where to go next. Exchange information. This communication was not a competition, but it was a real-life collaboration that helped make the game more popular.
So the original Legend of Zelda was intended to be played like a police zone search, where they get a bunch of people together to comb through a forest and everyone has their own section to search for clues. The police are you and your friends, the crime scene is the game map, and the body is your objective. Yeah, you could probably find what you're looking for by yourself, but how long is that gonna take? And at what cost to your personal life? I question the prospect of that idea anyway. Were people really able to complete this game simply through aimless wandering, experimentation, and word of mouth? As I understand it, the only way anyone was able to complete this game in 1987 was with a subscription to Nintendo Power. Walkthroughs. Even the game's manual contains a step-by-step walkthrough on how to get to the first two dungeons. Go north, young man.
Of course, back then, there were no chat rooms for people to trade ideas in.
People don't go to chat rooms now either, they just go to GameFAQs. Is there a single person, alive or dead, who has ever beaten The Legend of Zelda without a walkthrough or hints from a friend who has a walkthrough? I would feel very comfortable putting all the money I'll ever have on no. And just to illustrate my point, here is a video advertising a charity stream event that Rue from Clan of the Grey Wolf was going to be doing with Pat the NES Punk. These guys are fans of the game who know and love it.
Basically, we're going to be running a live playthrough of the original Legend of Zelda, and we're going to try to make it as complete as possible, getting all the heart containers, blah, 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 this, that, and the other, using only original source material, stuff you could only find if you were playing this game in the 80s. We got the instruction booklet, we've got the maps and strategies guide, little Pat's got a few other books and so forth, you know, because he collects sorts of crazy stuff like that.
The key word there is try. They were going to try to make it as complete as possible using only... Using only strategy guides from 1987.
It's going to be interesting. No internet walkthroughs or anything like that.
Well, I don't think that was too much of a hindrance, because that Zelda Tips and Tactics guide he showed is just about as complete as any internet walkthrough I've ever seen. And if you want to go to the highest possible example of someone who knows and loves the game but can't beat it by themselves, not even Eiji Aonuma, who designed Ocarina of All Time and produced pretty much every major series entry after that, has beaten The Legend of Zelda. I've never actually finished it. I almost feel like there's still no game more difficult than it. Every time I try to play it, I end up getting game over a few too many times and give up partway through. Certainly after playing the original Zelda for the first time, I didn't ever think that I wanted to make a game like that. Now, it's not clear if he's talking about beating it without a walkthrough, or if he's talking about the unbelievable combat difficulty of some of the later dungeons, but if that's the case, then Mr. Aonuma might have found it a bit easier if he had discovered some of the potions and equipment that you can find in hidden caves throughout the game. How do I know there are hidden caves in the game? Because the manual told me there were hidden caves in the game. Nothing in the game itself told me that. How do you find hidden caves? The vast majority of them can be found by bombing certain walls or burning certain bushes. How do I know that? Because I've played other Zelda games before. And because it's been 30 years and, you know, being involved in video game culture over time, you just kind of absorb all this information from various sources. But how would a 1987 player know that you can find hidden caves by bombing walls and burning bushes? Especially since there are no graphical indicators like the cracked walls of subsequent Zelda games. Well, they would have to either discover them by accident, which I find extremely unlikely, or they would have to decipher the hint in the manual. Link just might be able to pass through the pathways he hasn't been able to get through by using something else. Get the gist? Legend has it that there are caves in every possible place above ground. Link is bound to find them as long as he has enough power. Get the idea? You have to have enough power and use something else in every possible place. Get the idea? Oh, Nintendo Power, use bombs and candles and whistles to reveal hidden caves. Oh, tips and tactics, this is how to find the hidden caves. Looks like I didn't have to get the gist after all, haha! Here's the reality of finding hidden caves on your own. If you're going to be burning bushes to find them, don't even bother until you have the red candle near the end of the game. You can use the red candle as many times as you want on one screen, but you can only use the blue candle one time per screen. So to find this screen's secret cave starting from this direction, you have to burn this bush, leave, come back, burn this one, leave, come back, then this one, leave and come back, and so on and so on. Woe betide the player who starts from this side of the screen. Are there any hints or markers to indicate where there might be a burnable bush? No! Look at all of these bushes. Are you going to try every single one? This is fun? Burning 150,000 bushes to find the ones that might have caves under them, assuming you know you can do that. If you think you're going to be bombing walls to find hidden caves, have a look at this scenario. You start the game with an 8 bomb maximum. There might be a cave behind one of these tiles. There isn't, but you wouldn't know that. In order to open this hypothetical cave, your bomb explosion has to be within a half a tile of the entrance, which means it would take all 8 of your bombs to check every tile on this screen. In order to get more bombs to check more screens, you'll have to run all over farming enemies. 10th enemy has the bomb! What does that mean? Does it mean every 10th enemy you kill will drop a bomb? No, it means that you have to kill 10 enemies without getting hit, and if the 10th enemy is killed with a bomb, then it will drop a bomb, and it took 30 years and an examination of the game's code to figure that out, so you can forget about that little rule and deal with the RNG. Here's a chart that shows exactly how item drops work, which you wouldn't have access to, but it says that only specific enemies can drop bombs and only at certain times, so bomb drops are pretty rare. It's a better idea to buy them. 4 bombs for 20 rupees, which means now that you're farming enemies for rupees. And best case scenario, you'll be looking for hidden caves in an area halfway across the overworld from a shop that sells bombs. So what are you going to do here? Every single person I've presented this situation to has responded with the same answer. I'm gonna turn the game off. I have very funny friends. But you, the hypothetical person who wants to play this game in my scenario, are guaranteed to get frustrated and look up a walkthrough. So here's my question. If this game was designed with the intention that people would cooperate to discover secrets and solve puzzles on their own, but every single person since the beginning of time has been dependent on information that they got from walkthroughs, some of which were distributed by the very company that made the game, and one of which comes with the game as part of the manual, which is basically an admission that people won't be able to figure everything out by themselves, can we not then consider this a failure of game design? And by the way, I'm not the only person to bring this stuff up, but I do feel like I'm the only one who isn't brushing it all to the side. These are not small issues. The stuff I've been talking about is a significant portion of the game. Being an early open world game, I can understand that the concept hadn't been fully developed, but that's the problem, isn't it? People didn't know any better back then. But nowadays we do know better, and we're still saying things like The Legend of Zelda is the great grandfather of the action-adventure genre, an undeniable masterpiece that still holds up today. I would say that it is at best a rough draft, and it should be treated that way. You couldn't make a game like this now without making some sort of a meta commentary on retro game design. If you were to make exactly the same game now, but with modern graphics, people would hate it. But if you say, we're going back to 1987 rules, wink wink, and use an 8-bit graphics aesthetic, now you got yourself a game for the nostalgia crowd. What you'd really be doing is commenting on the progress video games have made since the 80s, and making fun of how poorly designed those old games are, which is why retro-style games are usually full of fourth-wall-breaking dialogue so that the devs can show you they're making bad design decisions on purpose to make fun of those old games. So I'm sorry, but I really don't care how good The Legend of Zelda was supposed to have been in the 80s. And I don't care how influential it was for other video game series. If you're trying to tell me that it's still a good game now, in today's world, by today's standards, then you either haven't played it for any significant amount of time without a walkthrough, or you're just wrong.
For more Twin Perfect, press the subscribe button. To support us, use the Patreon link. Goodbye.